Hello, my name is Monty Rowland, and I'm with Monty Gear in Sanford, North Carolina. One of the things that's come up lately is the whole concept of wearing a mask. As everyone knows, of course, the coronavirus is has been a disaster for our economy. There's all these, there's this astounding lack of trust in government institutions. And unfortunately, the astounding lack of trust has been verified time and time again. So kind of where we are is that the WHO as a worldwide organization has really screwed over the world. And we're specifically focusing on the U.S. here because they've been inconsistent. There's been time after time where it's not a problem, then it is a problem, then things like, well, there's really no asymptomatic transfer. This happened a couple of weeks ago. I mean, this is June. We've known there's asymptomatic transfer for months. So why would someone from the WHO come out and say that there's it's rare when all the evidence says that is crazy? The CDC, when this all came out, said, well, masks are bad. Only health professionals should wear them. A mask can increase your chances of getting the disease because you might touch your face because blah, blah, blah. It was all BS. They've come out recently and basically, I'm paraphrasing, but said that, hey, we told people not to wear masks because there weren't enough masks for the healthcare professionals and we didn't want to have people fighting over the supply of masks. Okay, so what that means is we weren't prepared and we lied to you rather than telling you the truth. Responsible government would have said, hey, don't go buy masks. We need to have enough for the healthcare professionals. Once we have enough for everybody, then you need to start wearing masks. Instead, they assumed you were idiots and lied to you. And that's what happened. Now, having said all this, the disease is not a political thing. People may be using it for political ends, but if you get the disease, it doesn't matter what your politics are. The virus has no filter that says, oh, this is a good liberal or this is a good conservative or good Democrat or this person believes in the virus, this person does. It doesn't matter. The virus kills and maims indiscriminately. And unfortunately, we've had crappy bureaucrats, managers, that instead of leaders in many, many locations and in the world with the WHO, in the U.S., with the CDC, at the federal level, at the state level. So we've had amazing amount of horrible decisions and people have been lied to. As a result, people don't know what to believe. So what I'd like to do is spend a few minutes and share what I've learned, and maybe that'll help you form your own opinion. Let me start out by saying that I think if you're listening to this podcast, well, no, I shouldn't qualify it that way. Let me start out by saying is that I have confidence that if you give the American people information, a large percentage of the population, if it's accurate information, will make a good decision. And there's always going to be people who make bad decisions. We can't stop that, no matter how great the information is, how well it is explained. But for the most part, I'm a believer in you being informed and then you making a good decision using your judgment. Unfortunately, that's not how most people are treated, but that's how you're going to be treated by me. And that's what I think. So let's roll into this. So one of the topics that has been just so misunderstood and so misinformation filled is, should I wear a mask? So let's start out by saying that the answer is, when you're interacting with other people that you aren't quarantined with, the answer is yes. So let's qualify that a little more. And let's say that, let's first throw out the case of, have you had the virus and can you get it again? If you've had the virus you should have antibodies. Now, however, can you get it again is an open question that really is not known at this point, because there's some cases that look like that people have gotten it twice, and the circumstances regarding that just aren't well understood. There's also a question of, we don't know how, do you get an immunity from a light case, or do you, can you get it again? This virus behaves in ways we just haven't seen before, from what I'm hearing from everybody. And so it's a question. It's an open question. So if you've had it before, maybe you've got an immunity. How long does that immunity last? That's unknown. The other thing let's dive in on is, can you physically wear a mask? All right, so there are probably some people who because of a, trying to think of a delicate way to put it, who have a mental condition that prevents them from wearing a mask. They are convinced that the mask is going to prevent the flow of oxygen to their brain, or they feel like they can't breathe, and they just can't get past it. And that's not necessarily their fault. There are people who are just anxious. There are people who talk themselves into that. And then there are people who really, truly have a mental condition. Thankfully, that's a very small portion of the world. I don't have an answer on how to do that, deal with that. But we can't base policy for the entire country on those few people. We have to come up with a way to help those people adapt, not change the policy for everybody else, because this is a big issue. Now, the other group of people, there are people who have a physical condition that makes it difficult to wear any sort of mask. Now, I'm going to make, and that really, let's be honest, is more tied to a respirator that really restricts your breathing ability. So there are people who have difficulty breathing, and restriction to that breathing ability is a problem. And how that compares from a N95 mask to a cotton mask, I don't know. But there are people in that boat. There again, it's a very, very small portion of the population. We can't define all public policy based on the small portion. Instead, we should come up with a way to help those people thrive and survive. All right, now, the other, let's start looking at the myths. So the first myth is that a mask doesn't protect you from the disease, because the disease is, an N95 mask is around 3 microns, and the disease is much smaller than that. But this is a myth, because it's really misleading when you tell someone that. Now, where this myth comes from is because that, or part, one of the places it comes from, let me restate that, is that if you take an OSHA respirator class, all right, and a respirator could be anything from an N95 mask to a respirator. Let's use a common term here, not be too specific. So when OSHA is looking at this, OSHA is looking at a total blockage of particles. All right, so they say, well, this has to filter down to this size. If a particle is smaller than that, then it doesn't help you, because over time you get this repeated exposure. And it's true. So there's two things to look at here. One thing to look at is that what we're talking about here, from the perspective of the coronavirus, there's two functions of that mask. One function of the mask is to prevent you from inhaling particles that could make you sick. All right, now, the other function is to prevent you from spreading particles if you're already sick. Now, we're going to have to take a side trip here, and let's talk about the concept of asymptomatic spreading. Now, it has been well documented, let me repeat this, that it is very easy to spread the disease asymptomatically. Now, what that means is that you can spread the disease without having symptoms. So you don't know you're sick. With this disease, you can spread symptoms for 2+ weeks before you get sick. Now, I think it's important to note that when you first get the disease, you're going to have less ability to spread than you are just before you start feeling bad. Okay. So this is because the disease multiplies in your body. When you're first exposed to the disease, I believe if I'm pronouncing this right, the term is the inoculum you receive. The inoculum you receive is the amount of virus that your body's exposed to. Now, there's a threshold, and it's going to vary from person to person, but there's basically a threshold where if you're exposed to the disease at this level, you won't get it, probably. Now, if you have a severely compromised immune system, then that's a different subject. But for the average person, there's a certain amount of this you can get exposed to without getting it. Once this disease gets in your body, it grows, if your immune system can't stop it, it grows exponentially. The virus, the amount of virus, the virus gets in there and it spreads. So a virus spreads by taking over cells, and the cells create more of the virus. And then that goes on to the next cell. And there's a complicated mechanism where the virus gets into the cell. So that inoculum, initial inoculum, determines A, if you get the virus, and B, how bad of a case you get. Because it's an exponential spread. So when you think about exponential spread, that's a very confusing thing for a lot of people. Exponential spread means that something grows exponentially, which is different than a linear growth. So if you have, let's throw out some arbitrary numbers. Because of exponential growth, let's pretend that, and these numbers aren't scientifically accurate, but maybe it'll help explain how the virus works. Let's say that your inoculum is less than 1, it's 0.5. And let's say an inoculum of 1, whatever those units are, it could be 1,000 units of the virus, or 100 or a million. So let's say that, let's just put it in easy terms and say that if you get 1 unit, how many ever copies of the virus that is, you will get the virus. If you get less than 1, you won't. Okay, so that kind of explains how your immune system might be able to overcome that. All right, so if you get 1, and it takes 14 days for the symptoms to show up, let's just give it a point here, then in 14 days, let's say that virus growth grows to, let's say, 14. Make it easy. If you get, which has to do with how long it takes for it to double. So how many days does it take before the viral load in your body doubles? If you get an inoculum of 1,000, then maybe because of this doubling and this effect, then you may have a load of, let's say, 100,000. And let's say that, just for simplicity, let's say that at 100,000 you have permanent damage to your lungs. If you get an inoculum of 1,300, then you might end up with 300,000 units of the virus in your body, and then that's what kills you. Like I said, these numbers are totally arbitrary. I'm just picking numbers out to explain the concept. But you can see the difference between getting 1, less than 1, you don't get it, when you do get it, 1,000, you have permanent damage to your body. In this case, let's call it your lungs. These are just arbitrary examples. But if you get a, let's say you get an inoculum of 1,300, then that's enough to kill you. So at this point, what we're trying to do is to limit your exposure to the virus so that if you get it, then the symptoms and the effects are less. And maybe if we can limit it enough, you just don't get it at all. So when people talk about masks not stopping the virus, there's two reasons why the mask doesn't stop the virus. So that is technically correct, but they're not giving you all the information. Maybe they don't have it. But so when they talk about like OSHA stuff, OSHA looks to prevent you from being exposed to chemicals and other things, possibly bloodborne pathogens, but they want to prevent that, and they want to prevent enough of an exposure that over time gives you a problem. All right, so maybe there's a fume, and your body can tolerate some amount of that, just like this virus, but when you get above that level, then that can over time, when you work at a job for a long period of time, that can harm you. So it's very similar in that OSHA looks at your total exposure, and viruses are much the same. It's a totally different thing, but it's still an exposure issue because we talked about, you know, what is that initial inoculum? So when someone says that, you know, they've learned that a mask does this and a mask does that, the mask is limiting your exposure to the virus, not preventing it. Because the virus can also enter through your eyes. So unless you're going to wear goggles, you're not going to completely prevent that exposure. Because the virus enters through a hole in your face. Nose, mouth, eyes. So if you're not wearing goggles, then that virus can go into your eyes and into your body. All right. So the whole thing about the particle size has limited value because it's only part of the equation. So what you want to accomplish by wearing a mask, the first thing you want to accomplish is you want to limit your exposure. But that's a secondary effect because if you're not wearing goggles, you can still get it in through the eyes. So, but if you can keep the initial inoculum down, then maybe you don't even get symptoms at all and you have the disease. Or maybe you don't even get the disease, you fight it off so quickly you don't even ever know you have it. And that's the best case. All right. So the first case is that you wear a mask, and hey, if you want to wear goggles, that's even better. And that mask limits the amount of inoculum you get. It does not prevent the virus from getting through. Now, but any mask helps some amount. Different materials have different effects for incoming virus. But there's also the effect of outgoing. So if you have an N95 mask or two or three layers of a surgical mask, then that's very good as far as keeping stuff coming in, as long as the mask is properly fitted. You've put it down below your chin. A beard or any facial hair will allow that air to go around between. So the facial hair spreads out the mask from your face and allows air to come around, forms a channel. So if you have facial hair, it dramatically reduces the effectiveness of the mask because you're pulling in air as you breathe. Now, everybody saw the study about how a beard might trap the coronavirus, blah, 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 and that's kind of up in the air if that's actually true. But the problem is when you wear a mask, it does reduce the effectiveness. There's no doubt about that. That's well-established science. Right. So the mask isn't going to completely protect you, but if you can keep the level of your exposure down, that may be enough protection. And even if it is only a small amount, that may be enough. All right, so let's say that a bandana, a bandana does very little to filter out the particulates entering your mouth. It's thin cotton. There's a lot of open pores. So fine particulates go right through it. And we're going to talk more about how a bandana helps in a second. But we're talking about incoming particles. So the idea is reduce the amount of inoculum. So use what you've got. If all you got is a bandana and it reduces 5% of the particles, that might be the 5% that prevents you from getting very, very sick because of that initial inoculum you take in. All right. The other part of the equation, and everybody wants to look at points. They have this one little point they want to pick at, and it may be true in isolation, but as a system, it's not. So let's go to the other side of this. The other side of the equation is how does that virus get to you? And that virus gets to you because someone breathed it out. So let's talk about how the virus actually comes to you. The virus cannot live outside of a host. In this case, it's unclear how many animals it can live in. So that's really unclear so far. We know it can live in people, but basically you're talking about a mammal. So let's assume that the only host that it really thrives in is a human being. So the virus, if not inside a body, will die over time. Surfaces the virus hits, the virus can live on different amounts of time. And I realize viruses aren't truly alive. So let's say the virus can be dangerous for a period of time. That's a better way to put it. So those surfaces from everything I've read, you know, cotton or cardboard, you're talking maybe a day, 12 hours to a day. Probably closer to 12. Copper, like 4 hours. Stainless steel or other metals, maybe 3 to 9 days, which is kind of scary. And I think that number is probably going to get refined somewhat. So let's call it 3 days. So the bigger problem, so that's a problem. So if you touch something and then you touch your face and that virus gets transmitted into your mouth or into your eye, then you can get that from contact. The most likely path for this virus to get to you is from someone's breath. Right? Now, no matter who you are, whether or not you are healthy or not healthy, as people, we breathe. Almost state the obvious. Now, we breathe, and there's some things that happen. When we breathe, we take in air, our body pulls oxygen out of it, it oxygenates our blood, that oxygenated blood keeps our bodies alive. Now, the process of breathing requires water. So if you don't have water, you can't breathe. And so your lungs are fairly moist. So when you breathe out, you push out a plume of water, droplets, very, very, very small water droplets, and then water vapor and so forth and particles. Now, the virus, the COVID virus, ends up in your lungs, and right at that air interface, there's virus there when you're sick with it. Even if you don't have symptoms, if you're sick with the virus, it is multiplying in your lungs. And so every time you breathe out, whether you have symptoms or not, if you have the virus and you breathe, you are spitting particles into the air. Not intentionally, and I'm not, this is not, but it is a fact. If you are sitting here, breathing, you're putting out humidity. I mean, you get in the car when it's cold and car windows fog up. Well, part of that's because you're warming the inside up and the outside's cold, and in cold air holds less, traps less moisture, but part of it too is the fact that you're breathing. So when you breathe, you spit out, not in a gross way, just normally in life, you put out this fog, let's call it. And this fog is made up of droplets. These droplets contain whatever was inside your lungs. If you have the virus, these droplets contain virus. All right, so you can't see it, but if you could map it, when you're just breathing, you're breathing out this cloud that hangs in the air because the droplets are very small. It takes a long time for those droplets to fall to the ground. So it might even be hours. Some studies have shown that when you breathe out, if there's no air movement around you, let's say you're in a room without any heat or air conditioning, then those air droplets can stay in the air around you for 2 hours. So think about that. Right now, what came out of your lungs as you're sitting here listening to this, you have filled your part of the room with droplets. And those droplets contain whatever in your lungs. Now, normally, nothing nasty comes out of our lungs, and everybody that walks into your space. So let's say you've created this 6-foot circle or 6-foot radius circle. So that's a 12-foot diameter circle where there's some level of particles. Now, if you're 6 inches away from your mouth, there's more particles that just came out of your lungs than if you're 6 feet. So because they have to diffuse out. All right, so that's where the 6 feet came from. Because the farther you get away from someone, the less likely that particle is going to reach them. Now, if you have air conditioning or heat or wind, those things carry those particles. Now, the good thing is that wind tends to spread those out because you're outdoors, it's more of a chaotic system, and so you're spreading those particles, and those particles could travel a long way, but if the person who breathes in those particles is far enough away and there's a small enough amount of those particles, let's go back to our inoculum, then you might not get the disease. All right. So when you're inside, it's even more of a problem because one of the things we found is that air conditioning or heat and air conditioning, the ventilation inside a building can carry those particles to other parts of the building. Now, let's go back to our inoculum of one. In order to reach that load at which you get sick, like I said, one's an arbitrary number, nonsense number. It's just, I'm trying to give a scale to these things. But until you reach enough particles to get sick, then you're not going to get sick. It varies by the person, the health, so forth. Now, so that means that if you reduce the amount of particles you receive to that point where you don't get sick, then it doesn't matter that that virus got to you. All right, now, so the longer you're in someone else's cloud, the more likely you are to get sick because the total amount of virus you're pulling into your body is increasing by the second. Every time you breathe in, every time it hits your eyeball, you're adding more virus load or inoculum to your body. Now, what we want to do is we want to reduce the amount of virus load that the person around you, people around you, receive. Because you don't know if you're sick because of this 2-week period, possibly up to 28 days reported in some places. You can be walking danger person. I mean, you're walking around, you're spitting out virus, you feel great, you don't know. But you're sharing that virus and possibly killing someone if that's the person that they get enough load and they die from it. All right, so I'm kind of taking this slow, but there's all this discussion and I want to maybe answer some of these questions for people. So the other part of wearing a face mask, and I'm going to argue the most important part, well, they're both important, but possibly the most important part for the society is a face mask slows down the velocity of those particles leaving your face, leaving your mouth or your nose. All right. Any face mask reduces the velocity of those particles. So remember we talked about before, let's talk about the 6 foot distance from you to any point, to a point. When you get out to 6 feet, the amount of particles that are making it 6 feet, unless there's air conditioning or wind or something blowing them, is dropping off quickly. It's an exponential function because it's radiating in a cloud. So it's radiating in 3D. So the amount of virus in that cubic inch of air is much less, much, 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 much less than it is 6 inches away. So what a mask does is a mask of any kind. Now, the higher the quality of the mask, the more the effect reduces how far those particles reach. So because it reduces the velocity of the air coming out of your mouth, and it also diffuses it. If there's no mask and you're breathing out, just think of it like a bullet coming out of your mouth. If there's nothing to deflect that bullet, the bullet goes straight. But what happens is that even with a bandana, some amount of that air, those air particles coming out, get deflected in all directions. What that does is that reduces the amount of particles that, let's say, reach our magic 6 foot mark. And that means that someone 6 feet away is less likely to catch the disease because most of those particles are staying closer to your body, which is a win. Because that means that you're not spreading the disease as much. Now, I want to throw out another thing. If you're singing, if you're yelling, if you're exercising vigorously and you're breathing deeper and you're exhaling more exuberantly, then that distance is farther because the particles go at a higher velocity. So think about it. If you throw a piece of paper, it goes real, throw it as hard as you can. Take a piece of paper and throw it as hard as you can. And as it leaves your hand, it's moving really fast. But because it's lightweight and because it's losing its velocity really fast, so you can't throw a paper as far as you can softball. Right? The same thing happens with the particles coming out of your lungs. But the more velocity you give them, the farther they can travel. And in this case, maybe instead of a 6 foot being a safe distance, safe being the point where you're not going to get the disease, the healthy person wouldn't, then maybe 21 feet is. Or some, you know, it's there's still a lot of, we're trying to figure this out. But needless to say that the harder you exhale, the farther those particles go because the more velocity, and the more those particles are likely to reach that person. The longer that person is in your cloud, then the more particles they're going to breathe in. So if you think about it, every time you take a breath or every time it hits your eyeball, you get more particles. If they're standing there for an hour, even a small amount could add up. If they're staying there for 2 seconds, they get less. And so the longer the interaction occurs or the longer the person is in your space, then the more particles they get and the more likely they are to get sick. All right, now, what a mask does is it reduces the size of the space of the danger zone of that space. In buildings, that space is really, really confusing because the air conditioning can cause spread because it affects that space. You can imagine this, you got a little air conditioning, you got a slow breeze blowing in your face to keep you cool, and then that spreads it out. It's happened in a restaurant where someone was sick and they got a big chunk of the restaurant sick. The people went back, looked at where everybody sat in that restaurant that night. The people who were downwind, i.e. the air conditioning was blowing the particles from the sick person's breath towards their table, they got sick. People who are upwind didn't. And that's because they got exposure over time from the sick person. Now, what a mask does is it reduces the velocity and it diffuses that air coming out of your mouth. The better the mask, the more diffusing. So an N95 is better. Surgical mask is not as good as an N95, but it's pretty doggone good. Bandana's not as good, but if that's all you have, and maybe you reduce the danger area from 6 feet to 3 feet. That's a big difference, because talking to someone 6 feet away is one thing. Talking to someone 3 feet away is a lot easier to achieve. So what's happening by everybody wearing masks, we reduce the distance that sick person can spread. All right, now, so that's all that. So that mask helps you two ways. So a cotton mask helps you some on keeping it out of you, but that cotton bandana mask helps a limited amount keeping the virus out of you, but it helps a lot by diffusing what's coming out. The better the mask, the better, no doubt. All right, so wearing a mask helps prevent you from spreading the disease. Now, so here's the next component of this, and you've heard this term R0. And I'm really working hard to try to put this stuff in just common terms, because a lot of people have gotten so much information, misinformation, and some good information, but it's hard to know what's what, who's lying to you, who has an agenda, who doesn't. So R0 is the number of people that a virus spreads to. So if you have an R0 of 1, that means that every person has the virus, spreads it to one person. Now, this is the statistical number, so it's an average. So an R0 of 0.8 means that a virus will spread very little, because one person gives it to 0.8 people. So the virus will die out pretty quickly after it's introduced to a place. An R0 of 30 means that one person gives it to 30. There are common viruses that get spread that, and disease, communicable diseases that get spread in massive ways. So the flu is typically R0 of 1.1 to 2.1. Coronavirus has been everything from 1.something to 7, throwing out the outliers. There have been super spreaders that gave it to over 100 people. Notably, good example is the lady that went to church in Korea. So that means that every person that gets the virus gives it to between 3 to 7 people. All right. If we want to stamp out the virus and stop the spread of the virus, then we reduce the R0 to less than 1. All right. So if you think about, and this is a tougher concept for some people to grasp, but if the zone, so if you can reduce, so let me back up. So the R0 is related to how easy the virus is to spread and the actions of people that have the virus and the actions of people around them that they could spread it to. So if you have a virus that is easy to spread and you don't take precautions, it's going to spread and the R0 is going to go up. So maybe you give it to 7 people. One person gives it to 7. If every time a person gets it, they give it to 7 people, the virus is going to spread like wildfire. If every time the person gets it and they give it to 0.8 people, it's going to spread, but it's going to die out very quickly. So that's why that is important. And so people's actions determine the R0, that range. So let's go back to, if you can reduce the size of your cloud that follows you around by wearing a mask, even say you reduce the size by half. If you're walking 6 feet away from someone and you're wearing enough of a mask to where your cloud of virus is 3 feet around, then, and you're 6 feet away from everybody, then the R0 drops dramatically, maybe less than 1. If you're not wearing a mask and you're 6 feet away, then that's at the edge of that danger zone and you can be spreading this. So that's why wearing a mask is important. And so when someone tells you that NIOSH this, NIOSH that, just toss that out, because they're not looking at the whole picture. The picture is we want to reduce the chances for this virus to go from one person to the other. The reality is you can spread it asymptomatically. All right, so you can look at this from a political standpoint, but the reality is there's the science of this is what's the critical part. And so you've got to separate the two, because what we want to do is reduce, we want to stamp out this virus. Now, I hope this clears up the whole why wearing a mask thing is important. Just to kind of summarize it, by wearing a mask, we reduce the likelihood someone else is going to get the virus from us. And if everybody reduces the likelihood, then the virus will die off and we can be past this. Now, it may come back and we're going to have to deal with that. But because we don't even know if you retain an immunity to the virus, and because we don't know a lot about this, you know, how long does your immunity last? I mean, let's face it, this is most likely a man-made virus, and it behaves in a way that no virus has behaved before. So you may not have an immunity 2 months later. And we're going to have to deal with those issues. But what we've got to do right now is we've got to get where people can go about their lives and work and go to the grocery store. And we've got to get that done. And the quickest way to do that is social distance and wear a mask. Now, higher the quality of the mask, the more it protects you and it protects the other people around you. It's absolutely, 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 absolutely. Did I say absolutely enough? No, once more. It's absolutely critical that you not look at half this picture. The whole picture is reducing your virus footprint. The virus footprint that you put out if you're sick and maybe don't even know it. If you reduce that virus footprint, less people receive the amount of virus that can make them sick. And it spreads less. And if we get the spread under R0 of 1, then that means that the virus will die out for now. Now, we're going to have to figure out how to deal with this in the long run. Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely true. But for now, what we have to do is get that R0 under 1. The way we do that is reduce everyone's virus footprint. And the way we do that is everyone wears a mask. If you can't wear a mask, that's a whole other issue, and that I don't have an answer for that. But everybody else, the other 99.something% of the population, needs to have a mask on. If you don't have a mask on, you are, and it turns out you're sick and don't know it, you are spreading the virus to people around you. And some percentage of those people, maybe 1%, you're going to kill. So let's look at this in numbers. Let's say that you give this virus kills, depending on, in the final number, if someone gets the virus bad enough to go to the hospital, it kills between 1% to 6% of the people. So that means if you give the virus, let's say, to 1,000 people, and let's say that 100 of them go to the hospital, then some percentage of that 100, in this case, let's call it 1 to 6 people, are going to die. And that means that if you had taken precautions, you could have prevented you from transmitting the virus to 1 to 6 people who died from it. So if you give that virus, in that 2 weeks, if you give that virus to 1,000 people, then you've killed 1 to 6 people. If you had given that virus to 1,000 people, the flu virus, you would have killed like 0.001 people. So this is totally different than giving someone the flu. Numerically, there is no, the math, and I don't want to dive in completely into that, but giving someone the flu, you would have killed 0.0001%. Giving people this virus, you would have killed between 1-6% of the people that went to the hospital. And of the people that you gave that the flu to that went to the hospital, you would have killed 0.001%. So, or 0.01%. I have to look up. Anyway, it's a small fraction. But so, and this is important though, because you could spread this virus to 1,000 people if you were sick and you had contact with a lot of people. That could happen. And maybe you give the virus to 7 people. You know, it's the R0 of 3-7, the likelihood is you're going to give it more like 3-7. But I threw out that 1,000 in case you ended up being a super spreader, which has happened. People have given it to people, more than 100 people. But so it's important to keep in mind that you can reduce your footprint, your virus footprint. If everybody reduces their virus footprint, then we can get over this and all go back to work. If we don't reduce this virus footprint, this is going to go on for a long, long time, and people aren't going back to work. So at the end of the day, you refusing to wear a mask keeps people from going back to work. So don't bitch about you don't have a job and then say you're not going to wear a mask, because people with your attitude are keeping yourself from going back to work. I don't know how much plainer to put that. We have to overcome this disease. We have to, or the virus, we have to overcome this. And wearing a mask is the best way to do that. And if we can do that and overcome it, then we can move on with life. And that's just critical. That is very critical. So keep that in mind as you're making your decisions. This is not a political issue. This is an issue of defeating a virus. And if you want to turn it into a political or an emotional thing, then all you're doing is making bad decisions, possibly bad decisions, by not looking at this in the proper perspective. And if a big chunk of the U.S. is making bad decisions, then we're going to be living with this virus for a long time. Our economy is going to be devastated, and far more people are going to die from food shortages, political upheaval, revolution, bad government, or tyrannical government than ever would have died of the virus. But we've got to get the virus out of the way. Otherwise, these things are going to follow. The best way to get the virus out of the way is to stamp out the virus. The best way to stamp out the virus is to wear a mask when you're in public. Any mask is better than nothing. So, I hope this helps. I know a lot of people are going to be pissed off hearing this, but I don't care, because this is an important message. And this is how you protect the people around you that you care for. Do you need to wear a mask at home? Probably not, because probably you're in enough contact that you've already shared. Now, however, though, if you start showing symptoms, you need to isolate yourself from other people in the home. That's a different discussion. But I hope this helps. I've tried to explain this as best as I can. I am a mechanical engineer, so I understand, and I've done a lot of airflow analysis, so I understand how particles move in the air, at least to some level. And I'm your neighbor. I'm not, you know, I don't have an elected position. I still have a job, thankfully. I'm working from home. I realize that that could change tomorrow, though. And if our economy keeps going down, then no one's safe. So this is what I've understood. I've been following this since January. I was telling people in January we need to be prepared, and people didn't want to hear it. So I've been on top of this. I've spent hundreds of hours listening to very different opinions. I've read and I've listened. I've watched, and this is what I've learned. And it's consistent. What I'm telling you is consistent across a variety of sources. Really, and what I've learned is only inconsistent across bureaucrats that keep changing what they're saying. So I think I'm giving you good science-based information that can help you make a decision. ultimately, you've got to make decisions unless mask wearing becomes a law, which I think it's probably going to, because most people are saying, I'm not going to wear a mask. There's enough people not wearing a mask that the disease is continuing to spread. And so those people are going to result in the government feeling like it needs to be mandatory because enough people just aren't going to wear masks. So the more mandatory, the more laws we have, the more we slip into tyranny. It's a totally different discussion, but the best way to get focus on the issues we have is to get other issues besides the disease, is to get past the disease. To get past the disease, we got to get the R0 below 1. We got to stamp this thing out as best we can, and we'll deal with it if it comes back later, but then we'll know how. So I hope this helps. Like I said, I'm just a guy that's your neighbor. I am a degreed mechanical engineer. I've done a lot of CFD or computational fluid dynamics. I understand how air flows, and I'm not a medical person, but I think I've learned a lot more about virology and medical stuff in the past few months than I ever wanted to learn. I hope it helps. Please don't hesitate to leave comments, criticisms. If all you can do is make a personal attack, then just stuff it. I don't give a crap what you think if that's the case. If what you're doing is you're helping me to better understand what I'm telling you, or if you're helping me showing me that I'm wrong, I will change my opinion because I want to get past this disease. My opinion is not that important. What's important is that we move past the disease. You know, I can change my mind. If you show me that I'm wrong, I will change my mind. And I would appreciate that because that's the best thing you can do for me, is to show me how to thrive and survive and do well in this environment. So I am open for that constructive dialogue. Hope it helps. And like I said, usually I'm talking about outdoor related stuff, but I just couldn't be silent about this anymore. Have a great day and stay safe and stay well. This is Monty Rowland signing out.